60s, we have a very academic and conventional theater prevail, but it will be knocked down in the early 60s with the coming of several directors, playwrights, designers, and actors who imposed a new vanguard of long-lasting effects which we still enjoy. So I can honestly say that we do not have a theatrical tradition in Mexico. We've got several. The tradition of change, of flexibility, of survival. Receptive to all artistic migrations, Mexican theater has been well nourished from the visionaries who thought their politics, their empathy, and their love, gave us their work looking for a space where they could work in freedom. It was not in vain that the surrealists called us surrealistic nation. Where does Mexican theater come from? Basically from dreams, from the conviction that we capture the imaginary of people's desires. We are the mirror of our society. We create that which will make the difference once the story ends. Muy importante de directores que fueron los tiranos de la escena.
Before, in the beginning we had an age of the directors who were very tyrannical, and they were called the tyrants of the scenic design.
En esta idea de rebelarse frente al texto y recontextualizarlo.
Right, the idea was to sort of rebel against the text and put it in a different context.
Estos directores hicieron cosas maravillosas, pero también ahuyentaron al público del teatro.
They did wonderful things, but they also made the audiences flee because they scared them away.
Porque era un teatro tan inteligente que no tenía nada que decirle al corazón del público.
It was a very intelligent theater, but not necessarily a theater that would say anything to the heart.
Y entonces los escenógrafos y los diseñadores mexicanos tomaron el control de esta situación.
So all the scenic designers, they took over and they started having control over this issue that started arising.
Especialmente uno, el más importante, que es Alejandro Luna.
Alejandro Luna being the most important one.
Y él fue el primero que replanteó el discurso del director.
He was the first one to actually sort of rethink the way the director would, the discourse of, the director's discourse in terms of theater.
Y repartió el trabajo de todos los participantes.
And started sharing with all the members of the cast, he started sharing this work that needed to be done.
Y él impuso.
Spanish arrived, and it is actually not that long ago if you think about it.
Las representaciones teatrales culminaban con un sacrificio humano. La representación teatral o el rito.
All theatrical representations or rites always ended up with a human sacrifice.
Que era sumamente colorido.
Which was extremely colorful.
De hecho, aquí he explicado un poco que en las primeras representaciones evangelizadoras de los españoles en México.
I actually explained in the text that in the first evangelical representations that the Spanish people gave in Mexico,
los jesuitas, que eran muy inteligentes, tenían una gran estrategia.
Right, the Jesuits, who had actually a very smart strategy,
encomendaban a los indígenas hacer sus representaciones a su estilo.
They would call upon the natives so that they would represent in their own style.
No permitían el sacrificio humano, pero
they wouldn't allow human sacrifices, but
pero permitían usar cadáveres sobre el escenario.
But they would let them use cadavers. Thank you.
Body, yes.
Cadavers, yes. On stage.
Existe en los archivos de la nación los primeros registros de producción de estas representaciones evangelizadoras.
Right, in the National Archives in Mexico, there are, it is stated that these kinds of performances, evangelical performances, actually happened at this time.
Que incluyen tanto dinero para cadáveres.
Right.
Compraban los cadáveres.
Which, within their budgets, you can see that they would buy, you know, cadavers, and that was the money that was allotted for them.
There's a budget line.
Yes.
Esa fue...